Harper Audio presents Significant Others by Armistead Maupin, performed by Cynthia Nixon, with an introduction by Rachel Maddow.
Hi, this is Rachel Maddow. San Francisco is the tip of a peninsula, jutting out into the water, a little suggestively, I've always thought. But by dint of that geography, the city is the size that it will always be. It is bound on three sides by water. It cannot grow. But honestly, the miracle of Tales of the City is that San Francisco never burst its banks. Once Armistead Maupin let us all know that we could live there, all of us, and that we could have whole, full lives there, not just defined by whatever it is about us that means we really shouldn't live anywhere else. We could have whole lives lived with others, and lovers, and neighbors, and friends, and maybe a pot-smoking landlady who you never want to leave. I remember as a kid in the Bay Area, crossing Polk Street in San Francisco, my face plastered to the back window of my parents' car, trying to catch an anthropological glimpse of these unknowable creatures that I had heard might exist there. The reason I believed for years that I was just broken, instead of not broken, but actually just gay, is because I could not connect the whole and complicated and mundane and interconnected day-to-day life that I had as a human and that I knew that adults had. I could not connect that with the one-dimensional caricatures that were the only thing I had ever heard about gay people. And when I met Mouse and Mona and Anna Madrigal and all their friends, and their sometimes salacious and sometimes mundane but always interconnected full lives and their storylines, that changed. Tales of the City is something that once it draws you in, you never want it to end. But for you, you lucky dog, it is about to begin.
For Terry Anderson, who took his time getting here. For Jane Stewart Maupin, who has been there all along. Note to the listener. The Bohemian Grove is a real place whose rituals I have compressed, though not substantially altered, to suit the time frame of this tale. Women Wood is a fictitious entity based on the actual practices of women's music festivals in Michigan, California, Georgia, and elsewhere. I am indebted to my friends in both camps. A.M. If you go down in the woods today, you'd better not go alone. It's lovely down in the woods today, but safer to stay at home. For every bear that ever there was will gather there for certain because today's the day the teddy bears have their picnic. Children's Song, 1907. Descent into Heaven. Brian's internal clock almost always woke him at 4:56, giving him 4 whole minutes to luxuriate in the naked human body next to him. Then the Braun alarm clock on the nightstand would activate his wife with its genteel Nazi tootling, and her morning marathon would begin. Today, with 3 minutes to go, he slipped his arm around her waist and eased her closer until her back had once again settled against his chest. It was risky, this part, because sometimes she would jerk awake with a start, as if frightened by a stranger. He pressed his face against her neck, then traced with his forefinger the shallow swirl of her navel. It was smooth and hard now, miraculously aerobicized into a tiny pink seashell. She stirred slightly, so he flattened his hand to keep from tickling her and made sure their breathing was still in sync. At the 2-minute mark, he eased his knee between her legs and tightened his grip around her waist. She groaned faintly, then cleared her throat, so he let his hand fall slack against her belly. She countered by squeezing his knee with her thighs, telling him not to worry, he wasn't smothering her. She needed this time as much as he did. The French had it wrong about le petit mort. If you asked him, the little death was not so much the slump after sex as these few piquant moments of serious cuddling before the demands of Marianne's career sent her vaulting over his piss-hardened manhood in the direction of the toilet and the coffee machine. Another Nazi, that coffee machine. Even now as he fondled her navel again, it was grinding its beans in the kitchen. The sound of it caused her to shift slightly and clear her throat again. "Like that?" she asked.
"What?"
"My belly button." "Took 700 hours, she said. "I figured it out." He chuckled at the tyranny of numbers that governed her existence. "Everything has a price," she was telling him. It was her favorite theme these days. She rolled over in his arms and poked her finger into his navel.
"Hey," he muttered,
uncertain whether the gesture was one of affection or reprimand. She wiggled her finger.
"Watch out," he said. "You fall in there and we'll have to organize a search party."
He waited for a faint cry of protest, but none came.
A half-assed, "come off it," would have sufficed.
But all she did was remove her finger and prop herself up on one elbow. "Well," she said, "I guess I'm up." He knew better than to argue with this pronouncement. He would only receive the standard recitation of her crypto-fascist morning regimen. Aerobics at 6, a bowl of bran at 7, a meeting with the producer at 7:30, makeup session at 8, a meeting with staff and crew from 9 to 9:15, followed by promo shots for the next day's show, and a session in the green room with this morning's guest celebrities. Life was a ballbuster for San Francisco's most famous talk show hostess.
"So what's the topic today?" he asked.
"Fat models," she replied.
"Huh?"
"You know, those porcos who model for the big and beautiful fashions."
"Oh."
"It's a huge racket," she laughed. "Pardon the pun." She bounded over him and swung her legs off the bed, yawning noisily. "The book's on the dresser if you want to take a look." As she headed for the bathroom, he brooded momentarily about the extra 10 pounds around his waist, then got up and went to the dresser, returning to bed with the book. He switched on the bedside light and examined the cover. It was called Larger Than Life, Confessions of the World's Most Beautiful Fat Woman by Wren Douglas. A glamorous star-filtered cover photograph seemed to confirm the claim. The woman was big, all right, but her face was the face of a goddess. Full red lips, a perfect nose, enormous green eyes fairly brimming with kindness and invitation. Her raven hair framed it all perfectly, cascading across her shoulders toward a cleavage rivaling the San Andreas Fault. "What is this?" Marianne was brandishing the roll of paper towels he had left in the bathroom the night before.
"We ran out of toilet paper," he said, shrugging.
He could do without her rhetorical questions at 5 o'clock in the morning. The alarm sounded.
"Fuck off," he barked,
not to her, but to the clock, which deactivated obediently at the sound of his voice. Marianne groaned and lowered the roll of towels, banging it angrily against her leg. "I specifically told Nuyette to make sure we had enough to—"
"I'll tell her," he put in. "She understands me better."
She also liked him better, but he wasn't about to say so. He'd shared a special rapport with the Vietnamese maid ever since he'd discovered that she couldn't tell the difference between raid and pledge. His pact of silence about the incident seemed the very least he could do for a woman whose uncle had been killed in an American bombing run over the Mekong Delta.
"It's just a language problem," he added. "She's getting much better, really."
Marianne sighed and returned to the bathroom. He raised his voice so she could hear him.
"Paper towels won't kill you. Think of it as a learning experience." "Right," she muttered back. "Maybe there's a show in it," he offered, trying to sound playful. "A dreaded new medical condition, like the heartbreak of bounty butt."
She didn't laugh. He thought for a moment, then said,
"Viva vulva?"
"Go to sleep," she told him. "You're gonna wake up Shauna." He knew what she was doing in there. She was reading USA Today, briefing herself for the show, learning a little about a lot, to keep from seeming stupid on the air. He picked up the book again and studied the face of the world's most beautiful fat woman. Then he switched off the light, burrowed under the comforter, and slipped almost instantly into sleep. he dreamed about a woman who had tits the size of watermelons. The next time he woke, his daughter was conducting a Rambo-style maneuver on his exposed left leg, propelling a green plastic tank up his thigh in an apparent effort to gain supremacy of the hillocks that lay beyond. Shauna invariably chose some sort of guerrilla theater over the simple expediency of saying, "Get up, Daddy!" He remained on his stomach and made a cartoon monster noise into the pillow. Shauna shrieked delightedly, dropping the tank between his legs. He rolled over and snatched her up with one arm, tumbling her onto the bed. "Is this my little puppy? Yum, yum! Puppy monster eats little puppies for breakfast!" He wasn't sure how this puppy business had begun, but he and Marianne both made use of the nickname. In light of Marianne's distaste for the child's given name, maybe it was simply their way of avoiding the issue without being disrespectful to the dead. Connie, after all, had named the little girl, and Connie had died giving birth to her. They couldn't just choose a new name the way people do when their pets change hands. Was that what puppy really meant? Something that wasn't theirs? Something they had picked out at the pound? Would the nickname hurt Shauna's feelings when she was old enough to consider its implications? He seized his daughter's waist and held her aloft, airplane fashion. The little girl spread her arms and squealed. He rocked forward, causing her to soar for a moment, but his butt made a graceless landing on the toy tank. "God damn it, puppy. Mommy didn't buy that, did she?" She managed to keep a poker face, still impersonating an airplane. He lowered her to the bed and reached under him for the offending war machinery. "It's Jeremy's, isn't it? You've been trading again." The kid wasn't talking. "I didn't buy it, and Mommy didn't buy it, and I know you don't take things that don't belong to you." She shook her head, then said, "I'm hungry." "Don't change the subject, young lady." Shauna sat on the edge of the bed and let her head dangle in a loose semicircle. The little charlatan was condescending to cute as a last resort. "What did you trade for it?" he asked. Her answer was unintelligible. "What?"
"My preemie," she said.
She slid off the bed, hitting the expensive new carpet with a soft thud.
"My cabbage patch preemie."
Her tone indicated that this was a matter of simple laissez-faire economics and none of his goddamn business. He felt a vague responsibility to be angry, but he couldn't help smiling at the inevitable scene in the condo across the hallway. Cap Sorensen, the ultimate Reaganite, returning home after a hard day of software and racquetball, only to come upon Daddy's little soldier playing mommy to a premature Cabbage Patch doll. Shauna tugged on his arm.
"Daddy, come on."
He checked the clock. 7:37. "Okay, puppy, go pick out a tape." This was his usual ploy to get her out of the room while he pulled on his bathrobe. It was no big deal to him, but Marianne thought it was inadvisable that he should walk around naked in front of Shauna. And Marianne should know. She was the one with the talk show.
"No,"
said Shauna. "What do you mean, no?"
"No VCR. Go see Anna."
"We'll do that, puppy, but not yet. Anna's asleep. Go on now, pick out a tape. Mommy brought you Pete the Dragon and Popeye, and I think there's..." A whine welled up in the child. She pawed the carpet belligerently, cutting a silvery path through the powder blue plush. He couldn't help wondering if parenting was an age-related skill like warfare, tolerable, even stimulating at 20, but inescapably futile at 40. He looked his daughter in the eye and spoke her name, her given name, to signal his seriousness. "I want you to go pick out a tape before Daddy gets unbelievably mad at you. We'll go see Anna later on." Shauna's lower lip plumped momentarily, but she obeyed him. When she was gone, he dragged himself to the bathroom and brushed his teeth. The floor was still wet from Marianne's frantic ablutions, so he mopped it with a damp towel and tossed the towel into the laundry hamper. He hesitated before weighing himself, then decided that the ugly truth was a surefire antidote for his late-night jelly donut binges. The scales surprised him, however. He had lost 4 pounds in 4 days. This made no sense to him, but he had never been one to argue with serendipity. Shauna threw her usual tantrum over breakfast. This time her yogurt was the wrong color, and there wasn't enough Perrier to make her cranberry juice go fizzy. Would she ever tire of testing him? After breakfast, according to custom, he let her pick out her clothes for the day. She chose a green cotton turtleneck with ladybugs on the arm and a pair of absurdly miniature 501s. He dressed her, then left her in the custody of Robin Williams and the VCR while he changed into his own version of her ensemble. The clock said 8:46 when he went to the window and peered down 23 stories into the leafy green canyon of Barbary Lane. From this height, Anna Madrigal's courtyard was nothing more than a terracotta postage stamp, but he could still discern a figure moving jauntily along the perimeter. The landlady was making her morning sweep, brandishing a broom so vigorously that the ritual seemed more akin to exercise than to practical considerations of cleanliness. Later she would cross the postage stamp diagonally and sit on the bench next to the azalea bed. For all her professed free-spiritedness, she was a creature of blatant predictability. He lifted his gaze from the courtyard and surveyed their vista, a boundless sweep of city, bay, and sky, stretching from Mount Diablo to Angel Island and beyond. There were no chimney pots or eucalyptus branches blocking their vision, no unsightly back stairwells or rocky rises framing some half-assed little chunk of water. What they had at the summit was a goddamn view, as slick and unblemished as a photo mural, and just about as real. Sometimes when he stared at the horizon long enough, their teal and gray living room lost its identity altogether and became the boardroom of a corporate jet dipping its wings in homage to the Bank of America building. Today the sky was cloudless and the air was clear. No hint of the Holocaust raging 60 miles south of the city. There, amid the brittle manzanita brush of the Santa Cruz Mountains, a jagged trail of fire 7 miles wide had already blackened 15,000 acres and driven 5,000 people from their homes. But not here at the summit. Nature wouldn't stand a chance at the summit. He sometimes wondered about that preposition. Should he tell people he lived at the summit, in the summit, or on the summit? Usually when pressed, he admitted to 999 green and left it at that. If he was embarrassed, he had every right to be. He'd lived in the shadow of this concrete leviathan for nearly 8 years, cursing it continually. Now, at his wife's insistence and using his wife's money, he'd joined the enemy in a big way. They had done it for Shauna and for security and because they needed a tax shelter. They had also done it because Marianne wanted a glossier setting.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.